So there's a lot of guides in life. Have you noticed? Today we're going to talk about sitting with the author. And I had a hard time finding a map, and then I saw one in the back. Somebody just had a map. But I went to three different stores yesterday, and all I could find was a laminated map. Do you remember the old maps that you would take out of the glove compartment, and you could never, you ended up wadding up some of them and just throwing them away because you got tired of it? And but this one's actually laminated. But here's what I want you to think about in life. You have a map. Everyone around you has a map. And here's the truth. In your life, your map is the way you think about things and the way you view people and the way you view God. But the problem is, if you only rely on your map, the one maybe that you learned from your parents or your experience or from television or movies or Happy Days, right? That's a TV show for those of you. Your map's wrong. Some of you, if I was to read your map, it would say you're a terrible person, you're a failure. God doesn't love you. You're not doing enough to please God. If your good outweighs your bad, then you're okay, and if it doesn't, then you're messed up. You're a disappointment. You're ugly. You bother people. You're better than everybody else. And all of us have our own map, but let me let you know something. God's word is the map that was drawn by the author. And the awesome thing about God's word is he doesn't just give you the map and say, figure it out. It is the only book, and by the way, it's more than one book, we'll talk about that in a minute, but it is the only book in the world where the author sits with you. When you look at life, you have convictions about things. A conviction is just a deeply held belief. Some of you right now, you've been a Christian for a long time, and maybe you even know what the Bible says about you, but you sit here and you think, I'm worthless. Or you sit here and you think, that person's worthless. And yet, when we look at the map of God's word, he begins to correct our map. Some of you grew up in churches where it was legalism and rules, and they were telling you, if you do these 10 things, then God loves you, and if you don't do them, he doesn't love you. You have a conviction that's wrong. Others of you have a conviction about who Jesus is and who he said he was, because as you've read God's word, you realize what he said. You just haven't let it sink in yet. But that's one awesome thing about the Bible, and we're going to talk about a little bit of that today. As we talk about this idea, the principles, we're going to look at some principles of reading the map, and know that the Holy Spirit is the one that helps you. It's like GPS, you know, with the map. He helps to clarify what the Bible says. So let me ask you this question first. Does what you believe about yourself today line up with what the Bible says about you? Because you have beliefs, as you sit here, you have beliefs about yourself. You have beliefs about the people next to you. Does that line up with God's word? See, as we read God's word, he wants to give us convictions about sin in our lives, things where we blow it. Sin just means to fall short. Everybody falls short. Everybody does things they wish they hadn't done. If you drove with me, you would see that. We have beliefs about who Jesus is, we have beliefs about ourselves, and we have beliefs about others, and we need to come up with a conviction that comes from God. Now, the other night, I was flipping TV channels, and I ran across an old TV show, and I heard these words, I pity the fool. Now, who knows who I'm talking about when I say I pity the fool? Does anybody know who I'm talking about? If you don't know who I'm talking about, you need to find I think it was an early 80s show, The A-Team. And Mr. T was in the A-Team, but he started out. If you've never heard Mr. T's story, Mr. T is a Christian. Mr. T just went through a very, very hard trial in his life. He had cancer, and he wasn't expected to live, and he's still alive to this day. And Mr. T, when he first became a Christian, or early in his Christian life, he came across this verse in Proverbs 23, verse 7, that said, as a man thinks, so is he. So instead of listening to those outside influences in his neighborhood and the rough area where he grew up that said, you're just going to be a failure, you're going to go to jail, he began to believe, you know what? I can be anybody God wants me to be, and I'm going to be strong. And then if you don't know the story, he entered a couple of bouncer competitions and won. You may not know this part of the story because the news doesn't share this. Before the first bouncer competition, he went to his pastor. At this time, he was living in his car. And he said, Pastor, if I win this $10,000, I'm going to give it to the church. Sure enough, he won. And even though he's living in his car, he gave that money to the church. It wasn't long after that that he suddenly got a contract with some little movie called Rocky III, right? Who do you believe you are? And does who you believe you are line up with who God says you are? Listen, when we talk about Bible study, when we talk about spending time in God's Word, it's not just supposed to be an academic exercise. Some of the things I'm going to talk about today are kind of academic. Some of you have been in church for years and you've heard them. But if you don't begin to say, God, through these things, would you help your Word sink into my heart? Lord, where my map has been drawn the wrong way, would you correct me? Would you show me how much you care and love me, how much you hate the sin in my life, but you don't hate me? And you're going to help me to walk through this. So first, let me give you a few excuses for not reading the Bible. Why I don't read the Bible. Number one, I don't have time. Number two, every religion has their own books. By the way, I deal with people who aren't Christians all the time, and these are things I talk to them about. If you ever talk to your friends about Scripture, you'll hear these same things, okay? Number three, it confuses me. Number four, it doesn't apply to me. It's ancient. Why, you know, how does that apply to me? Number five, when I read the Bible, I feel guilty and worthless. So let's look at some answers to excuses. And let me tell you what the enemy's going to do in your life, just so you'll be aware of it. I think sometimes the best way to overcome things in our lives is to understand. Just like Mr. T had that verse where he knew that God could make him strong, the enemy typically will come at you with one argument your whole life. You think, oh, no, he comes at me in a myriad of ways. No. Typically, we have one argument that we believe. So maybe for you, the enemy comes to you and says, you're worthless. Maybe the enemy comes to you and tells you you're not good enough. Maybe the enemy comes to you and says nobody likes you. Or lose hope. Or you'll never make a difference. Or you don't matter. And if you pay attention and look through the past in your life, you'll realize there's a theme. And a lot of times the enemy will use other people also to make sure you know what the enemy's message in your life is. I once had a pastor tell me, you know, Eric, God told me to tell you something. You're a pest. Can I tell you who told him that? And it wasn't God. But it's made me realize that one of the biggest messages that I will get from the enemy all the time is, Eric, you bother people. When you're ADD, you do bother people sometimes, and that's all right. So what's the message, though, that the enemy has spoken to you? Number one, let's look at these things and why it matters. You have time for what matters. In Luke chapter 9, this man came up to Jesus and said, I will follow you, Lord, but first, let me go back and say goodbye. And by the way, this word here for goodbye in the Greek, it's like, let me get everything in order to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts his hand to a plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. So this guy said, Jesus, I'll follow you when I get my act together. Okay, I would like all people who have their act together in this room to raise their hands. Everybody who has their whole act together, raise it. And if anybody raises their hands, we're going to stone you. Okay, but okay. That was a joke. Okay. So we don't, and we know we don't. And the truth is, if we're not careful, we think, I'm going to be good enough to then come before God. You're not good enough. It's about surrender. And then he says, if you start to follow him, and then you start looking at your past, and you look at what you did, it's just like a man with a plow. And in modern society, it would be like my friend who was driving one day, and he had put his bowling ball in the back seat. He didn't have a case. He didn't have a bowling ball purse, as Jim Gaffigan calls it. So he put it in the back seat, and as he's going down the road, he slammed on the brakes, and the ball rolled over into the passenger side of the back seat. So as he was driving, he turned around to try to get that ball. And as he turned around to try to get the ball, he was swerving all over the road. And little did he know that the popo was watching. And they pulled him over. And they said, "Sir, can you get out of the car?" He tried to tell him, "Hey, it was my bowling ball. I was turning around." "Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Would you please try to walk this line for us, sir? Would you please touch your nose?" And they walked him through the entire sobriety test because he was driving so badly because he was turned around. The policeman wouldn't even believe that he wasn't drunk. A lot of us as Christians are spending time looking back instead of saying, "You know what, God? If your word matters in my life, I will make time for it." You make time for what matters. If today I said to you, "Hey, I've got 2 free tickets to Acapulco, all expenses paid. You just have to be at my house at 5:00 tomorrow morning, and it's a week, and we're going to hang out on the beach in the nicest resort there is, and I've got 2 tickets." You would figure out how to go to Acapulco. You would call people. You would have a dog sitter. You would call in sick to work or whatever you had to do. Some of you quit your jobs, right? You would do what you needed to do if it mattered to you. And if I said, "You got to be at my house at 5 a.m., some of you have never seen the 2 fives that are on the clock. You only know, you're a musician, so you only know there's a 5 p.m. You don't know about the 5 a.m., right? But some of you would get up, but yet we can't get up to spend time in God's word because we don't value it. I'm going to do those questions real quick. It's just, can you be honest about your priorities? Number 2, the Bible's not just a book. The Bible is actually 66 books with 40 different authors written over 1,500 years with one theme, redemption. And when you look at the Bible, even when you look at the story of Adam and Eve, did you know psychologists now are using the story of Adam and Eve as an example of human nature? Because we still do the same thing. What happens? We do something wrong, what do we instantly do? And not only that, by the way, if you really read the story, Adam not only does this, but he does this. He says, "The woman you gave me." And then the woman's like. And Satan's like, okay. Satan's the only honest one in the story. Isn't that sad? You look back in Scripture and you see examples all through history. In 2 Peter 1:20, it says this, "Most of all, you must understand this. No prophecy in the Scripture ever comes from the prophet's own interpretation. No prophecy ever came what the person wanted to say, but people, led by the Holy Spirit, spoke words from God." This idea of led in the Greek is the idea that they were carried along. That God used what they said to transmit what he wanted to say to us. Yes, God used their personalities. Luke was a doctor, for example, in the New Testament. And so there tends to be a lot of detail in what he talks about. If you know Paul's history, as he talks in the book of Hebrews to the Jews, he knows what he's talking about. It's the things he learned. But God uses that. People will come to me, and this has happened over and over again. People will come to me after service, and they'll say, "How did you know that's what we were dealing with?" Actually, years ago, one of the funniest things, and this happened twice, but one of the times a guy got really mad at me. He came, stormed up to me after the service, and he said, "I know my wife called you this week, and that's why you talked about that." And he'd never come back to church again. I'm like, dude, number one, I didn't talk to your wife. Number two, I really don't have time to do a personalized sermon for everybody in the church. But he just assumed because I said it that somehow I knew something. Listen, God will do that through his Spirit. He will speak to you, and he will use his word, and he used men led by the Spirit. Unlike any other religious book, the Bible was not written by one person, and yet it has one theme of redemption. How we blew it, and Jesus came to redeem us all through Scripture. Are you willing to look into other proofs? If you're struggling, "Hey, I don't know if I can believe the Bible," take some time to do some real research. Don't just get on the internet and look up what some kook says, okay? But spend some time looking up proof. My friend Mike Minot, who is an attorney, came to faith in Christ after he studied the proofs for Scripture. The other thing I realize is this. I know how the Bible impacts me. It changes what I believe about me. It changes how I deal with life. And I know and I see God's power not only in my life, but in other people's lives. Number three, don't read the Bible like a novel, but as a guide. When you read the Bible, it's different than every other book. So don't just try to get through the Bible in a hurry. Don't go in a hurry and try to do as much as you can. I went to the grocery store yesterday. Okay? Can you imagine if I sent you to the grocery store and I said, listen, we're having spaghetti this weekend, so I need you to go and get some pasta, get some sauce, get some hamburger, and some sausage. We're going to make meatballs. I just made all of you hungry, right? And you walked into the grocery store, and you were gone 10 minutes. And you came back, and I said, hey, did you get the stuff? No, but I looked at it. What? Did you realize you can live in a grocery store and starve to death? When you read the Bible, don't just look at the ingredients. Don't get in such a hurry that you just read a verse. That's like reading the back of the bottle. Take time to say, God, listen, for those of you who've never read the Bible, here's what I would do. I would go to the New Testament, okay? Second half. New Testament means new contract. When Jesus came, we no longer had to be under the law. We were under grace. And I don't have time to go into all the Old Testament stuff about that. But we became under grace where we receive his gift of freedom, of salvation. God is withholding his wrath. So you come to the new covenant, and if you've never read the Bible, go to the book of John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. By the way, people have asked me, hey, you know, I started reading the Bible in Matthew, and I'm in John, and they keep saying the same kind of thing. Well, yeah, it's the perspective of who Jesus was by four different authors. So anyway, you get to the book of John, and just read one story. And then say, God, would you use this in my life? Don't get in such a hurry just trying to check off a checklist. Now, most of us have driven to work, and we don't remember driving to work. You ever done that? Scientists have actually done studies that after you do something, a certain amount of times, your brain literally turns off. Isn't that a nice thought? So you get somewhere and you're like, how did I get here? We do the same thing with the Bible if we're not careful. You read the Bible and as soon as you read it, you close it and you go, what did I read just now? Sometimes you'll have to reread it. Spend some time. Let it soak in. And take time. You can, as this next advice is, read in different translations. Read small portions. The Bible was written in Greek, which is a picture language, which means that a Greek word can have 10 different meanings. And sometimes for me, like I've read the NIV most of my life, King James early on. I like now doing my Bible study using the New Century Version. I have my doctorate degree. New Century Version is written at a sixth grade reading level. I love it. Because when I'm reading it, I'm like, you know, I know it has always said that, but somehow that spoke to me that time because of how I read it. So take time. And then finally, ask the author to speak to you. When was the last time you read the Bible and said, God, show me in your word about me? Number four, ask God for help in applying the Bible. Remember, the Bible is the only book where you're sitting with the author, where he wants to give you power. As you read the Bible, just like Mr. T, God may give you a verse. By the way, if you don't have a favorite verse, get your Bible out. Maybe you're struggling with anger. Get your Bible out and do a search. Listen, I've got a Bible app on my phone. I can look up any verse in about 3 minutes. Every day I sit down, I take the daily bread, and I look up the verses for the day, and before I ever read their thing, I just read the verses, and I write, what does this verse say? And what does it mean? And God, is there anything in this verse to apply to me? So take some time to do that. In 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, it says this, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That idea, all Scripture is God-breathed. That's the symbolism is that of God putting life into Adam. Remember, it says he breathed into Adam. Do you ever feel dead? You ever just feel like mundane? Like life's gotten dry? God wants to breathe new life into you through His Word. He's breathed into His Word. And as you read His Word, He can breathe new life into you. And then it says it's for rebuking. We don't like that word rebuke, but it basically means conviction. He's trying to convict us, to show us what we did wrong. Isn't it good to have a map sometimes when you're driving and then suddenly you realize, I'm lost. And you're not just lost in love and you don't know much. If you understood that joke, you are getting old. All right, so, I know, I'm old, I'm there. So what happens when you realize you're lost? What do? You go and look at the map. There's times when you're reading the Bible and God will show you an attitude of your heart. You'll think, I am just doing great, and And the Lord uses it to convict you. And then the OCD's favorite word, correcting, which means to straighten. OCD people are like, I love that word, correcting. I'm not straightening the picture, I'm just correcting it. You people who flip the toilet paper over, you know, you real detailed people, can't stand it to be this way or that way, you actually care which way it's on. That's what the Bible does. It corrects you, it fixes you, it straightens you when you get off kilter, and then it trains you, it tutors you. Some of you, your whole life, have been listening to wrong messages. Some of you have been in church for years, and listen, can I tell you a secret? Your pastor may have taught you wrong or demonstrated to you wrong. That's the reason. Listen. Always, regardless of what I say, always go to God's word and say, what did God say? Because guess what? I'm not perfect. I'm not infallible. I know that's a shocker to some of you. But here's what's awesome. As we read God's word, God in His perfection will use imperfect people. So as you're having a Bible study with somebody that you know, wow, they're really messed up. Oh, that was for me. Because that's what the Holy Spirit does. Some of you, your whole life, have heard that you're worthless. God sent Jesus to die for you. Some of you, listen, somebody told you one day maybe, hey, you know what? It's just not worth spending time with you. And you feel like God gave everything for you. And when you really begin to let that sink in, it changes your map. And it changes how you feel about you. And then guess what? It makes it easier to deal with other people. When you realize you're not in competition with other people, it changes your whole life. When you realize God created you to be you. You know, I struggle with that. You know, being hyper, there's a lot of people who tell, calm down. You just need to calm down. You know, Brookings, you just really need to calm. You drive everybody crazy. You're a pest. Remember, you're a pest, right? And God said, I made you just the way you are. So what was the Bible saying to them back then? And what does it say to me now? One of my favorite books is 2 Timothy because I realized that Paul was in prison and Nero was in charge and one of his friends, most likely Seneca, had just been killed and Paul's sitting in prison and he's writing to Timothy to encourage him. He's saying, Timothy, here's the most important things. So when I read 2 Timothy and I know that about it, the book of 2 Timothy comes alive. What was happening at the time? And then the second question is the harder one of the two, because I can look up the history, but I don't always like to be right with God. I just like to be right. But do you really desire to be right with God? If you're going to spend time with Him, you have to desire that. And then number five, receive God's love and forgiveness. I know that there are people in your life that have misused the Bible. They misuse the Bible to manipulate people and to control people. Listen, they use everything to manipulate and control people. Pay attention. Don't be manipulated or controlled. Read what God's Word says for yourself. Spend time in His Word. God is absolutely righteous. That is absolutely true. But the awesome part is He loves you. And the whole reason Jesus died for our sins is because you and I will never get it right. You are broken. You are messed up. You are a sinner. But here's what's awesome. But you're saved by grace. So the cool thing is if you're a Christian, you don't even have to call yourself a sinner anymore. You can say, I'm a saint now, which is pretty awesome. It says it in Scripture. So I'm a sinner that's now saved by grace. Some of you are still living over here in the, well, I'm just a sinner. And you haven't received what the Bible said about you, which is God has made you righteous. He has made you holy. That He's changing you from the inside out. He's doing what we like to call metamorphosis. It's from the Greek. It's the idea that He's transforming you. Have you been transformed at all? If you're really reading the Bible the right way, God will begin to transform you. You'll find wrong ways of thinking. You'll see ways where your map is wrong. You ready for this one? This is the big one. You ready? Hang on. Buckle up. You'll see where you're treating other people selfishly. God will show you the self-centeredness in your life and in your heart. I don't like that part. I like to think that I've got it together. I'm very loving and caring. But we can even do the right thing for the wrong reason. And so we allow the Holy Spirit to change us as we read His Word. John 3:16, here's the good news. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish. That means to die, but will have eternal life. Let me tell you what this verse means to me. When I was in the hospital, there was a time that I thought I was dying when the doctor came in at 2 in the morning to do surgery. I said to the doctor, "You don't normally come in at 2 in the morning, do you?" No, I don't. And he even told me just recently, I saw him, and he said, "You know, I thought you were going to die." I said, "I thought I was going to die," so we were on the same page there, right? Here's what I knew. The worst thing that could happen to me is that I would die, and the worst thing that could happen to me is I would wake up in heaven. Wow, that changes your perspective. One day I won't be here anymore. I don't know how it's going to happen. I don't know that yet. Some of you have gotten a diagnosis. You think you know how you're going. But here's the good news. Regardless of how bad it gets, if you're a Christian and you've given your life to Jesus, one day you'll go from here to there. The sun will set here and it'll rise in heaven and you'll be there for it. Amen. Now, for God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world. Would you please tell your Christian brothers and sisters that? He didn't come to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. The word gospel. Means good news. Most Christians, by their faces, you can't tell that we have good news. Let me tell you about Jesus. Oh, you need some good news, dude. Or some prunes. I don't know which one. All right. Did I say that out loud? All right. Have you received His forgiveness? If you're here today and you're not a Christian, you've never received His forgiveness. Now let me show you some ways. This is not in your notes. Let me show you some ways that God's Word, here's a picture that there's a bunch of these online, but this is a great one. I love this. What you say, what God says, and where you can find the Bible verse, okay? And you can look this up online, just Google those three words and you'll find it, okay? You say, "It's impossible." God says, "All things are possible." You say, "I'm too tired." Sound of Music. No, that's from My Fair Lady. All right. "I'm too tired. I will give you rest. Nobody loves me." You ever feel that way? Everybody feels that way. Sometimes we relate to Charlie Brown. "I love you." "I can't go on." That's our Eeyore voice. "I can't go on. My grace is sufficient." "I can't figure it out. I will direct your steps." "I can't do it." "You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you." "I'm not able." God says, "All right, I'm able." By the way, my sister, when she comes to church here, she says to me, "Eric, I know God's real." I'm like, "Really?" She's like, "Yeah, because I know that's not you. I know you, and you couldn't do this." I'm like, "I know." Great to have a sister. All right. "It's not worth it. It'll be worth it." "I can't forgive myself. I forgive you." And can you receive God's forgiveness even for you? Some of you can forgive other people, but you can't look in the mirror and forgive yourself. "I'm afraid. I'm not giving you fear. I'm always," that's spelled wrong, "I'm always worried. Cast all your cares on me." "I'm not smart enough." I get this one all the time. "I'll give you wisdom." "I feel all alone." Anybody ever feel lonely? Did you know a third of married people constantly feel lonely? Those of you who are single are like, "Really?" Yeah. And let me tell you the worst thing in life. The worst thing in life is to have somebody near you and still feel lonely. But when you begin to recognize God's always with you, no matter where you're at, no matter what's going on, you don't have to feel lonely. You can talk to Him. By the way, if you talk to Him in the car now, used to be people thought you were crazy. Now they just assume you're on your cell phone. So you can go down the road and go, "Jesus, thank you for today." And people who see you are like, "Look, they're on the phone." "I can't manage. I will supply all your needs." Now this is just a touch of the promises of God, but I want to encourage you to spend time in God's Word. Now, these next three points I'm going to give you very quickly. These are taught in the 201 class, so I'm not going to read all the verses. I put them there for your reference, all right? But listen, if you're struggling with something, look it up in the Bible. Look it up in the Bible. Look up the key word. Maybe you're struggling with feeling alone. Look up alone. There's all kind of apps for your phone. If you don't like it on your phone, you can actually get the Bible, and in the back, there's a concordance. You can look up words. If you need help, come see me. I'll help you. How to spend time in the Bible. Here they are. Number one, what does this verse mean when it was written? When they wrote this, what did that verse mean? Sometimes we don't understand it because we don't know that. It doesn't take long to look that up anymore. There's so many resources. Number two, what is the eternal principle in this verse? For example, in the New Testament, there's a verse that says, women don't wear earrings, basically. My mom last night when I said this one. Woo. But what it's talking about is they were basically dressing like prostitutes. And so the Bible was saying, hey, when you go to church, don't dress like a prostitute. That's a pretty eternal principle. I think that's probably good advice. I told some parents that one day because their teenager was having a hard time. They said, I really want to talk to her. What does the Bible say about it? And I said, well, it says don't dress like a prostitute to church. Okay, I'm telling her that. Number three, how does this verse, here's the big deal. This is where most of us don't get. How does this verse apply to me? Apply to me. Listen, all of you have convictions in your life. Some of your convictions are wrong. Some of your convictions are based on what somebody told you, especially about you or about other people. Maybe about God. Maybe about sin. You may have a belief that there is no such thing as sin. Hey, begin to look and compare your map, your convictions, to what the Bible says. Don't argue with people about their map. Just say, well, this is the map I believe. Because God inspired Scripture. He wants to give you convictions about sin. He wants to give you convictions about who Jesus is. He wants to give you convictions about you, what God thinks about you, and about other people. Don't waste your life running through it so fast that you don't take time to look at the map and say, am I running the way God wants me to go? And let me end with one last thought. When you get lost, and if you've ever gotten lost on the way somewhere, if you're like me, you tend to drive faster and faster and faster because you got lost and now you feel late. Some of you right now feel that way in life, and you're going through life faster and faster and faster. Hey, pull over for a minute. Take time to read the map and make sure every day you're going the right direction. It may feel slow. It may feel burdensome. But when you read the Bible with the author, he will show you the truth. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, John 3:16 says it well, that he died for your sins, not to condemn you, but for you to have eternal life. If you're here today, we don't do a formal invitation, but at the end of the service, I'll be here and you can come and say, Eric, I want to give my life to Christ. Maybe you're hearing the truth be known. You know the importance of God's word. As I'm talking about that, you're just sitting there sinking lower and lower into your chair. Listen, it's not about feeling guilty. It's about saying, you know what, God? Tonight, I'm going to spend time in your word. Or tomorrow morning, I'm going to begin to build that habit into my life, and I'm going to listen to you as I read your word. I encourage you to do that. We're going to have our time of giving in just a moment. Giving is one of the things, when you look in the New Testament, that Jesus said to the Pharisees, hey, you should continue to give. You're not giving the right way, but you should continue to do that. So I want to encourage you, as you give today, you give what God's put on your heart. He'll take care of you. He always takes care of us. Thanks for being here today. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Lord, there's so many things I could talk about today, but Father, I just pray that today we would be reminded of how your truth changes us, how your word, as we evaluate our own thinking and our own beliefs and our own convictions, how when we put them against your word, so often you change us from the inside. Lord, I pray that the Bible would never become a legalistic book to hurt other people with. But Father, instead we would see it as you meant it, as a love letter to us. Father, help us to share that good news with other people. Father, for anyone watching online today who's been struggling with how they feel about themselves, I pray that they would begin to dig into your word and receive what you say about them. Father, we receive your love and your grace. We thank you for your conviction that reminds us of our sins, but also your forgiveness that sets us free from sin and from death. Lord, I pray you bless this offering today. Each dime that's given, that you'd use it to help people come to know you. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great song to close our service. I pray you'd reflect on this today. Thanks for being here.